Welcome in, everybody, to whatever. Baseball and whatever. We have a very fun show planned for you. But before we get started, our co-host, Vincent Francis Jankiewicz IV, has a special day coming up. So before we get started, I just wanted to mention a few things about him. But like I said, nothing gushy, nothing embarrassing. Just a few words about...
Outstanding. Mr. Wallace, call the president. Tell him if he doesn't sign the bill lowering the cable rates, we'll release the video of him with a cheerleader in the Chicago motel room.
Inspired, sir.
And after he signs the bill, release the tape anyway.
Consider him slimed.
That's right, we are back with a special episode of Consider Him Slime, fully dedicated to our co-host, brother-in-law, and glorified fact-checker of the Baseball and Whatever podcast, none other than Vinnie Vincent Francis Jankiewicz IV. And if he thought he could be a part of this podcast and avoid any sort of involvement with slime, he is sorely mistaken. So we're going to have some fun. So welcome in. My name is Greg Probst. I am the host of Countdown to MLB the Show. Please listen to that. And joining me for the special edition of Slime is none other than our editor-in-chief, Justin McAwee. Justin, welcome in.
Thank you. Editor-in-chief sounds really official. I don't know if, is that really what I am?
That's what you are. I think that's what you are. And reluctant leader. I think
I'm anybody who wants to take the lead, I'm better at someone delegating to me and delegating to someone else. So,
well, that's okay. I'll take care of the intro for Slime, since this is the little mini pod. I guess I'll take the front seat on this one. Justin and I will share some stories about Vinny for his birthday. All well wishes, of course. Nothing embarrassing.
No, especially. Never.
And then we had a ton of people write in for this episode. Friends, family, probably the most we've ever had. So we'll read everything that has been submitted about Vinny and maybe some surprise guests along the way.
Interesting.
Like I said, we are the Baseball and Whatever podcast, partnered with the Belly Up Sports Podcast Network. Visit them at bellyupsports.com and follow all of us on the social medias.
I'm thinking we should make this the Belly Up TV episode too for the week. What do you think?
I think that's a great,
I'm sure
great
if Vinny's
idea.
Listening, he's like, oh God, no, please don't do that.
We have a ton of content, so this might be our most, like I said, this might be our most content-filled episode.
That's
so,
true.
Justin, you ready to get started?
Let's do this thing, Greg.
I'm going to kick it off saying, so we brought Vinny on this podcast, so we did the trial first episode, which we have an anniversary coming up where we went over the PS5. Justin is now a proud PS5 owner, and we went over the Snyder Cut, which I finished, so we've made progress in our lives within a year. And then Vinny came on for the second episode, I believe. What did we cover? The NFL draft?
You keep vamping. I am looking it up right now.
Either way, he jumped on and he immediately started throwing out, you know, facts and everything, and you know, just a wad of information. I'm like, ah, see, this is working. This is the podcast right here. So the three of us. So I think that was the money shot. Right over there. But we love having him on. He is our glorified fact checker and now our soundboard operator. He's becoming quite masterful at that.
So. Yes. So our first episode was April 15th, 2021, baseball and PlayStation 5/ Snyder Cut. And then Vinny came on. Episode 2, April 21st, 2021, baseball and Bears NFL Draft QB Trivia. And I believe... I still remember him emailing us and saying, all right, I have all these trivia questions I'm going to ask you guys. I think this will be fun. And it was a smooth fit, all three of us getting together talking. And he was the fact checker right away from the get-go, for sure.
Yes, he was. I think I even asked him, like, what if the Bears, if Justin Fields is there at 9 or 10 or 11, wherever he was, I'm like, do you take him? But he said they would. And that's absolutely what happened. So, he kind of predicted the future right there. So one story I wanted to share about Vinny is this is a good story, I guess, but I'm going back now. I'm wondering why we did this. But when we went to Cedar Point, he and I mean, we were riding the roller coasters as, you know, bunch of us in the family were
going. Except me.
So except you, Justin. Was I did not ride. I was the bag holder.
I was the bag holder.
So while Justin was standing there waving at us with his cotton candy.
I just want to say none of the bags got stolen on my watch. So you're welcome, true. Everybody.
Thank you. We appreciate it. What bag did I, was I carrying a bag?
No, I don't think you were. No. Oh,
okay. But there were bags and you were holding them.
I was holding them to the best of my ability.
So for some reason on every ride and at Cedar Point, I think the like train cars are smaller over there. So Vinnie and I were for some reason we got in the same car and he's 6'6" tall and I'm 6'6" wide. So these rides are so rickety to begin with. I think Mean Streak was the worst. I don't think that ride's there anymore, but it's just this rickety wooden ride. That was a ton of fun. But I think most of the ride, Vinny and I are scrunched together in the little train car. There's barely enough room for one of us if we rode solo, but let alone two of us. So the whole entire ride, we are just screaming in pain. You know, oh God, oh my leg, oh my knee. And for the parts that were non-painful, Vinny's got like this little high-pitched laugh, you know, this little,
he does.
This little giggle. Oh, I can't even do it that high, but he was like a little kid in a candy shop on that roller coaster. So when I think of Vinny, that is the first thing that comes to mind. My roller coaster buddy right over there. I remember, Justin, you were about to jump on one and then you backed out.
The last, as we were walking out of the park, there was some really old rickety wooden roller coaster. And I'm like, you know, this is it. It was the final night. I guess I can hop on. And then I think everything was shut down, which was perfect timing. I didn't actually have to follow through. In my defense, though, we did the water park the day before, and I did all the water slides. So at least I did those.
There you go.
I did
there
do those.
Go. Look at you, you big, brave man right
yes.
there. Yes. So, yeah, Vinny and me are roller coaster buddies, and hopefully we get to, you know, do that again because Cedar Point is a ton of fun, and maybe we'll finally get you on that roller coaster.
You know, stranger things have happened. So I guess we can go with that.
So what about you, Justin?
The one major story that comes to my mind is I remember my wedding was 2013, which gosh, it's gonna be 10 years next year. But anyway,
oh, it is. Wow.
I should remember that. Anyway,
that's a big one.
It is a big one. We gotta get through 9 first, though. We'll see what happens. So no, I remember for our wedding, Vinny was one of our groomsmen. And obviously you and I had just started hanging out because I think that year we met you, right? Does that sound right?
I believe that sounds right. Okay. Yeah.
So Vinny was already one of the groomsmen. And I remember the church we got married at on the south side in Oaklawn. Shout out to St. Gerald's. We got married there and they kept the groomsmen were all put in the confessional. Why I don't know. And the bridal party was in a separate room, you know, on the other side of the church. But the only room they had for the groomsmen was this confessional. And when I was a kid, confession, you know, was the similar to what you saw in Seinfeld, where you walk in and there's the
of course,
and you kneel and all that. And after I had done my first confession, all that stuff, it changed to more of just an open room, and you were just face to face talking to the priest, which I was never a fan of.
Really
never went back to confession after that.
Your podcasting has become your
confession. It is. That's my confession. Yeah, if I'm going to confess all these horrible things I've done, I don't want the person to be looking me right in the eyes. I want there to be a divider, you know. But anyway,
that's not the point, you know.
So we had, I think I had like 5 or 6 groomsmen, and we all fit in this confessional, and I'm just sitting there hanging out, you know, trying to. This was before I was medicated for my severe anxiety, and I was just trying to chill and stay calm and everything. And I was pretty mellow that day. I remember, I think Lynn, our mother-in-law, came in to check on me, and she's like, "Oh, you're much calmer than I thought you would be." And I was like, "Yeah." But anyway, so there's all these groomsmen, and we were in our, you know, mid-20s at that point. And for some reason, Vinny got the great idea to act as a priest, and he was granting us all absolution, asking for our sins. And giving us penance and telling us what prayers to say to grant us absolution. So, you know, we had our first house in Oaklawn. I grew up in Oaklawn, so I went back to that church many a time, and I couldn't look at that confessional without laughing because I was thinking of Vinny doing his best job as Father Jenkowitz, giving absolution to everyone. So That is definitely one aspect. Like you said, Cedar Point, there's a lot of funny things about Cedar Point, but yeah, it was a good time. Going to my bachelor party with him. I still remember sitting in the bleachers with him, as we talked about on my birthday podcast you guys did. I was very worried that he would be nervous driving through some of the rough parts of Chicago. Okay.
Since you brought that up, yes. I'm going to interrupt you right there. When we decided to do your birthday pod, and this was before we got all in depth and everything, but he said, you guys, for your bachelor party, you stopped off and got cupcakes.
Yes.
What was that about? Cupcakes at a bachelor party.
My bachelor party was amazing. It was planned by my best man, my other friend, Greg. The other Greg. It's so funny when I'll say, oh, Greg told me this, my dad will stop and be like, wait, which Greg? Is it Greg, brother-in-law Greg, or Greg, best friend Greg? Which one is it? I got to clarify for him. Yes, the plan was to go to a Cubs game, but it was awesome. We started driving downtown, and being on the south side, you gotta drive through some rough neighborhoods, unfortunately, that, you know, maybe have it a little tougher than what most people do, unfortunately. But Vinnie, not being from Chicago and growing up out in, dare I say, the boonies out in Freeport.
Pretzel land.
Yeah. I remember calling him because he was in the other car, and I said, hey, Vinny, you know, I know you're not from here, so you might be surprised by some of the neighborhoods we go through, but, you know, we'll be through them in no time, and then we'll be downtown in the loop and everything like that. And the response I got, he was just like, oh, okay. Like, why is that a big deal? And he just didn't really react. I'm like, oh, maybe he's much calmer than I thought. Well, it was me that was kind of projecting on everyone else, but, no, it was a blast. It was a lot of fun. Yeah, it was just good times in general. He's always been a nice guy, and it's so nice we get to do this every week, 'cause I feel like we stay in touch now way more than we did prior to doing this, because we'd only see each other at family parties and occasionally text each other. So it's,
exactly. It's a lot more fun. Our lives have become so much busier right now with family and kids. I mean, I got one sitting on my lap right now, hoping she doesn't unplug, you know, my computer. Otherwise, you're going to be doing this on your own for a couple minutes, Justin.
It's all right. I can keep it going. But no, it's been nice to do. And I feel like, yeah, like I said, the three of us is all brother-in-laws. It's been great. We've gotten to do some amazing things on this show that I never would have believed we've been able to do. And I'm excited to see what else happens down the road. And it's great that the three of us are a part of it. So
absolutely. It's great having him on the podcast. It really makes everything click. We got all perspectives covered and everything. Yes. So, and he's checking all of our facts, especially when we're labeling off numbers or whatever.
He's the numbers guy. So
maybe you'll handle our taxes if we ever start making money off of this.
I told him he could be the chief financial officer once we make enough money.
David Wallace of the podcast. And that soundboard, he is killing that soundboard. So we gotta get him a hookup with a big board.
We need to look at
running out of hotkeys, or get him a second external keyboard or something like that.
Oh, so, there you go. That's a good idea. But yeah, there you go.
But we have someone special right here. Do you want to say happy birthday to your Uncle Vinny? You want to say happy birthday in the microphone? Oh, well, no? if you can't see, if you're listening on audio, little Aviana is saying no. So, but that's okay. So how about we jump? Like I said, hold on a second. Oh, my goodness. Like I said, we have a ton of friends, family writing in. So we're going to get to some of that. I feel we should kick it off. Do you want to? We'll start with some of his friends, maybe. I'm going to kick it off with our first submission we ever got, ever since we kind of put out all the notice and everything. And that is none other than the very punctual Brian Waters.
Brian's a good guy.
He was our first person to write in for you, Vinny, if you're listening. So Brian Waters writes, it's nearly impossible task to pick just one, since Vinny was the closest thing I had to a brother growing up. And I think I can definitely attest to that, too, since none of us had brothers growing up. So we definitely feel that bond. The memories that always stick out in my mind are the pop song parodies we'd write about donuts on our endless car rides to soccer practices / games. It seems like every single song we heard on the radio, we'd write about donuts. We even had a comic book that we wrote about Captain Donut Hole.
Oh.
You were obsessed with donuts, which may explain why I'm pre-diabetic. Oh, man. Spending hours upon hours hanging out in the car on the way to soccer provided us with the opportunity to entertain ourselves in the dumbest ways no one I've ever met could laugh as hard as Vinnie. Happy birthday. So Vinnie had a donut thing going on there for a little while.
I want to feel like that seems odd, but I could totally see that being the case with those two. I don't know about you.
Where can we get a copy of Captain Donut Hole?
Yeah.
Has he ever mentioned that to you? This is the first I've heard of
this. This is the first time I've ever heard of Captain Donut Hole. And now I will be definitely bringing that up tomorrow at the family get together that we're
having. There's got to be a copy of that sitting around the Jenkowitz residence.
I would argue that we might be able to find something about that maybe tomorrow if we bring it up.
I'm hoping so. Well, let's find out more about that. Brian, thank you so much for writing in. You were the first right away as soon as we put out the memo. So thank you.
For sure. For sure. All right. Let me go on. We have Mike Batista and Tim Morgan. Back when Tim, Vinny, and Mike all lived together while attending Edgewood College, it was almost a nightly occurrence that the three would pile onto Tim's couch and enjoy some lighthearted episodes of The Office, Ridiculous, and the like. One evening, as the three laughed along to an episode of Ridiculousness, a video was introduced by Rob Dyrdek, and what ensued couldn't have been any funnier or terrible, depending on who you ask. In fact, you've probably even seen the video yourself. It consists of a man holding a bowl, attempting to trap a huntsman spider that is on the ceiling in Australia. Before I continue, here's some backstory. Our friend Vinny, obviously 6'4" tall, which, yes, he always makes me feel so short whenever I'm standing around him. I think I'm definitely the shortest out of the three of us anyway. But
yes, you are, Justin.
Vinny, 6'4".
But nothing to be ashamed of.
No. So Vinny, 6'4", muscular, athletic, ruggedly good-looking and handsome. Well, Vinny happens to be deathly afraid of spiders, and now we return to this nightly ritual. Rob Dyrdek rolls the video. Tim and Mike watch with delight as pure and utter terror consumes Vinny's entire being. You can see his hands get clammy, his face is losing color, and his knees being pulled into his chest as the spider slowly moves across the ceiling in the video. Then all of a sudden, the man with the bowl lunges at the spider, misses completely, and sends the spider falling on top of his head and on its way to the ground. The next moment, our 6'4" tall, muscular, athletic, ruggedly good, handsome looking friend, Vinny, lets out a high-pitched, blood-curdling scream that one would surely expect to shatter glass. Vinny bolted from the couch, screaming, sweating, panicking, straight to his room, vowing to never, ever watch another video with a spider in it again. Tim and Mike, however, got one of the biggest laughs of their lives, along with a story that will never be forgotten by Vinny. Happy birthday, Vin. We love you. Which, I'm starting to sense a trend when it comes to spiders in the Jenkowitz family.
I was just going to say, so is this like one of those things where we call a Jenkowitz thing where it's just a general arachnophobia?
I think it's just general arachnophobia because Erica, my wife, Era, Vinny's brother, is deathly afraid of spiders. I'm assuming Ashley, your wife, and the other sister is deathly afraid of spiders, correct?
Yes,
very much so. I didn't realize Vinny was afraid of spiders.
I swear I saw him kill a spider once before. I thought he handled it like a 6 foot
like a champ,
tall, muscular, athletic, ruggedly handsome man. So
yes. I don't know.
So, but I do buy the high pitched blood curdling scream. That tracks, you know, at least with the roller coaster stuff that I mentioned earlier. So I think I know what that sounds like firsthand. So even though with the roller coaster is more joy, I don't know if I've heard the one in terror yet. So maybe a spider will pop up this weekend or something. Maybe we'll hear it firsthand, catch him by surprise. So,
Vinny, if you're listening, you're on notice. Just be ready.
We're watching you. This next one comes from Jeet Rout. I hope I'm saying that correctly. One that stuck out to me was when I went down to Western Illinois University to visit him for his birthday. The first day involved downing Vinny's version of Riot Punch from It's Always Sunny watching It's Always Sunny and then attempting to go to a party afterwards. Spectacular failure. We were way too drunk. The next day we went to the swimmer's house and played wizard staff, but started making non-traditional weapons. Where is this going? By the end of the night, there was a sword, a hammer, a scythe, a shield, and whip. We all had fought in a battle royale, and our friend Jason destroyed everyone with his whip, which was about 80% duct tape and 20% aluminum cans. We were all drunk and in pain. I think Vinny especially. So birthday lashings, best. Jeet.
That's incredible.
I don't even know what to say to that. Did someone take a video of this? I'm not quite sure, you know, if I'm envisioning this correctly.
So. I feel like I've heard that story vaguely, but
okay.
Jeez.
So is this something like Jim Carrey, Matthew Broderick, medieval times, or something like that?
That's what I'm envisioning.
That's the first thing that came to mind. So.
That is what I am envisioning, and I'm loving every second of it as well.
That is fantastic. Especially with the variety of weapons they had in a battle royale. So, and
yeah,
apparently Jason, who we'll get to later, winning with the whip and his all drunk and in pain. So, all right.
Fair enough.
We love it. Thank you, Jeet, for writing in. So
all right.
Definitely want to hear more about that.
We have Zach Richardson, who has written into the show before. That is Dr. Mantis Toboggan. That's
our guy.
So he's got multiple stories. He's got three, actually. So let's go with the first one. It says, Vinny was quite the mischievous teenager, which our father-in-law was telling me about this the other week. In high school, he became involved in many car wars. The typical egging or saran wrapping of a car was Vinny's standard yes. Friday or Saturday night. However, he once took this too far. Oh, this is the story I heard. Yep. With friends who shall remain nameless, he once covered a rival's car in roadkill. Yes, you heard that correctly. If memory serves me right, there was at least one raccoon, a couple squirrels, and half a possum that was taped and stuck or shoved into a car. Car wars ended quickly very after that. There is way more to the story, but I'm not going to say that because it's not my place. But anyway,
I think we'll get to it again later.
Okay.
So maybe more will be covered.
Maybe we'll go from that.
I think this will come up a couple times.
Okay. So. Number two, say one thing about Vinny, but he's also a competitor. Vinny's kingdom in junior high was gym class. Though puberty had hit, Vinny had yet to learn how to coordinate a body composed mostly of arms and legs. Vinny's number one attribute was his intensity. For whatever reason, Vinny approached junior high gym class like it was a killing ground, a Hunger Games, if you will. Vinny was so crazy in gym class, our teacher, Mr. Casper, nicknamed him Vinsanity.
Vinsanity.
This is not the Vinny Jankowicz I know. I don't know about you, Greg, but I'm thinking of mild-mannered accountants.
When's Vinsanity going to come back?
I don't know. I hope we see it soon. Vinny would run full speed into a wall to keep a basketball in bounds. The teacher would yell, Vinsanity, after Vinny would give someone a purple nurple in the middle of class. The Vinsanity continues. He then made all of his friends call him Vinsanity, and he was very proud. Well, I know what we're calling him tomorrow. Vinsanity.
Vinsanity. It's going to be part of the intro. Edit the intro, Justin. Vinsanity.
All right. Number three, random fact, Vinny is an old soul at heart. To make sure he gets his steps in, Vinny would frequently go on early morning walks carrying 5-pound weights in his hands.
Oh my God.
Doing exercises, and this was in his 20s, signed Dr. Mantis Toboggan, MD. I'm thinking now of the Office episode where Michael has like the 4-pound weights in his car. And they're like, oh, you're trying to get a bulk? He goes, no, I just want to be toned.
Toned, yeah, going I just want to be toned. So is he wearing a little head sweatband too? Maybe
I like to think he's got a fanny pack too.
Oh, so is he carrying 5-pound weights in his hands, just power walking or something? Oh my God, Vinny.
That would be like an 80s soccer mom kind of thing, wouldn't it?
I believe so. So I wonder if he's still doing that. I don't know. He's in his 30s now, so I don't know if he's.
We're going to talk about it tomorrow when we see him. I can tell you
maybe,
that much.
Maybe he's like Benjamin Button that ages backwards.
That could be. That, you know what? He's been looking pretty dapper lately. You never know.
Yes, he has. Our next submission is Jason or Jaybird Hamburglar, friend of the pod. He wrote in some really good stuff again in three parts. Actually, Justin, you and I are going to split this up a little bit.
Sounds good.
So I'll take part one and three. You'll take part two, if you wouldn't mind.
Sure.
So Jason starts with golf pros and tennis hoes plus three G.I. Joes. Vinny, Zach, and myself were bored one night and heard through a few people that there was going to be a giant house party in one of the middle of nowhere subdivisions with massive yards and wooded areas. Our great idea was to dress in camo and go mess with the party. little did we know it would turn into something much more heart pounding. And I'm pretty sure it was the worst talking to we've ever gotten from our parents. Ooh.
Mm.
We pull into the subdivision at 9-ish p.m., of which half of it was still under development. We do a drive-by to confirm the house, go and park maybe a mile away, and start a trek in. We are covered from head to toe in camo gear and can confirm there was a laser attached to an airsoft gun. Oh, so they're pretty much just playing all gillied up from, Call,
from
Duty,
Call of Duty
Modern Warfare. So, hey, I dig that.
Yeah, for
we
sure.
made our way through the backyards and wooded lots to the side of the house and stage in a giant bed of the hostas. We start periodically using the laser on the house and people coming into the party. So they're laser pointing, like there's like there's snipers out there or something like that. We thought this was pretty cool until we noticed a lot of commotion at the front door. We hear cops run and house deflates of hammered people out of the back. Nice. We come up with a plan to make our way up the side yard and make our way to the truck. At this point, there were a bunch of cops and drunks hiding in the bushes around the house, and we make our way back. At this point, the cops have flashlights out and are spotting people left and right. In the fury of flashlight beams, we all pick a tree and duck behind to find cover. I love this. Zach and Vinny are further away, so communication was shot. The beams start moving around, and they end up moving into a tree, into the tree line in safety. I am stuck behind a tree, shimming around, and my belly waiting for an opportunity to break for a different tree line. That is great. Vinny can't fill you in on where the heck they ended up, but I made my way up through some backyards, dodging beams of light, ended up swimming, crawling through part of a retention pond at the end of the tall grass area, a little off from the truck. That is dedication. I admire that so much.
Oh my
I see
God.
A cop car from behind me, and now I see Vinny and Zach come out of a freight patch and start running up towards me. I yell, cops, and hit the deck while they jump back in the patch they emerge from. The cops use a spotlight but can't see me, and I don't think they knew Zach or Vinny were even there. We all reach the truck with chest pounding and 20 pounds lighter from sweating while running through the woods in the middle of the night in full camo gear. We purposely left cell phones in the truck, and we all checked them to discover it was close to 2 a.m. and all our parents have been calling all night. Uh-oh.
That's not good.
We make it out of the subdivision and are relieved we didn't get caught, but dreaded the parent talk we were all going to get. I am pretty sure we all got grounded for some sort of time frame. I love that story because I've been in similar situations.
Oh, yeah.
Especially some of the Sauganesh woods and stuff like that, or avoiding cops after parties. That is all great, great stuff right there. So
that's excellent.
And I appreciate the full camo gear and like the tactical approach to this party. I'm not sure if the plan was to assassinate someone, but the fact that they got away and just getting a dreaded parent talk, that's not so bad. What did Henry Hill say in Goodfellas? Everyone takes a beating. So
yeah.
Yeah. So it could have been a lot worse. So
it could always be worse.
It could always be worse. So great story.
All right. So let's go on to the second one here. It says it was senior year of soccer. That's another thing, too, if our listeners don't know. I know Vinny doesn't talk a lot about it, but he was a avid soccer player in high school, middle school, too, I think. Right. And he was from the stuff in their dad's basement, I want to say he was pretty good. I think he was a defender, if I'm not mistaken. Does that sound right?
Oh, I'm not sure. I don't even know if I know this, what the positions.
I know Erica played. Erica, I want to say, was a defender too. I thought Vinny was a defender.
Well, we kind of touched on it too. We wanted to find out more when we talked to Perry.
That's right.
If you haven't listened to that, go check out that interview. But yes. he kind of gave us a scouting report on Vinny a little bit. Yeah. And not only that, but a competitive swimmer too.
That's true.
He's got those long arms and everything, so he's probably like
he's gangly
out there.
He's gangly. So getting back to the story, though, it says it was senior year of soccer and we were playing one of the lowest ranked teams in the conference. By halftime, it was a blowout and our coach heavily advised us to not run up the score on purpose or to go out of our way to score. Well, Vinny didn't hear that message at all. The team inadvertently scored a few more goals, which pissed our coach off. At this point, there is a fierce beast ready to explode out of Vinny. He had a look in his eye and I felt that what would come next should have been on SportsCenter. At this point in the game, it's 9-0. God, the other team has the ball in our end, and Vinny usually played midfield. Okay, there we go. He was a midfielder.
Okay. Vinny
is guarding the unsuspected player in our box and gets the steal. The game went from 11-on-11 to 11-on-1. Vinny literally went coast to coast, juking guys left and right, nutmegging. I'm not quite sure what nutmegging means. A few more guys to get down to their goal and does a pullback of the ball. With some attitude and, of course, some adrenaline from what just occurred, he scores the last goal of the game. At this point, no one knows what to do, but Vinny takes off his beanie soccer hat and starts hooting and hollering with double fist pumping in the air. Thinking about it, it reminded me of a mixture of Conor McGregor and Rampage Jackson.
Nice.
He was at an all-time high, peacocking around, and could you blame him? I'm pretty sure he got benched or reamed pretty good in the middle of the game. Well played, Vinny. Happy birthday from the Hamburglar.
Love it. Vinny's showing that emotion on the field. It's that competitive nature.
He's got it.
The last part of Jason's submission here, it was senior year of high school, and for post-prom, the school brought in a hypnotist. It was all fun and games until Vinny volunteered or was selected. I am not sure he even remembers this at all. The hypnotist had him up on stage and gave him directions. When you hear these words, hug the person next to you. He was originally next to me, but was placed in the middle of groups of African-American girls, none which suspected anything. The hypnotist goes on with her show, and about 10 minutes later, everyone is laughing and settled in. The key word is said, and Vinny pops up and starts going to hug anyone close by. All the girls get up and run away screaming and laughing. The room loves it, but Vinny is literally lost since no one is next to him and he's stuck in the hypnotist's grip. There is no one else on the cafeteria table bench except Vinny at one end and myself at the other. If Vinny was going to go down in this unexpected circumstance, then there was only one thing left to do. I slid down the bench and I'm glad I did. Best hug I ever got in high school. Happy birthday, Vin, from Jason.
Great stuff.
You ever been hypnotized, Justin?
No, I have not. How about you?
No, I haven't, but I've seen things in high school where they've brought them in. I've seen plenty of old classmates hypnotized.
I'm like,
so
interesting.
Never been myself though. Always been curious about it though. So
yeah, I you know, there's some.
I don't remember. I haven't heard. I've heard some of these stories, but so far, I don't think I've ever heard that one. So that's interesting. Have you ever hugged Vinny? I think I've hugged him a couple times.
Maybe at a funeral.
Maybe a funeral.
Maybe at a wedding. Maybe at my wedding when the groomsmen are coming up down the aisle. Maybe
he looks like a good hugger. He's got those big strong arms.
He'll pick you up and set you down somewhere else. He's a giant.
Exactly. All right, so we are moving on. We thank you to all of Vinny's friends for submitting all of your wonderful stories. We are going to move into some submissions we got from his family. So Justin, you want to lead us off right here?
Sure. All right, this first one comes from Paula, who I believe is Vinny's sister-in-law. I believe that's his wife's sister. She says, it was New Year's Eve and we were at a party where I brought homemade blueberry vodka and Vinny and I were taking pulls of it from the bottle. At the end of the night, everyone told us that we had blue rings from the vodka stained around our lips. Gretchen texted me later and told me Vinny couldn't leave the couch at all the next day because he was so hungover and he may not have peed his pants when he got home from the party, thinking he was at the toilet. It took a turn. I did not expect
that. Oh, man. That's great.
Wow, man. That's something I could see your wife doing to me. That's savage.
Yeah, for sure. I think that definitely tracks.
It does. There's a bond between brother-in-law and sister-in-law.
Yeah, there is. I don't know. There's a special bond right over there.
There is.
Great story. Next, we have a very special person writing in. And we, Justin, you and I both know the mother-in-law's.
Yes, special, so very nice lady.
Planned special introduction for Barb, and then we'll get to her submission. But first, a little introduction for her. One more hour, one more shot, one more bottle. Let's get one. Everybody getting loco, getting crazy with the bar. Keep on partying, spend the money, celebrating every night. One more hour, one more shot.
We don't need to get into that story, but
thank you, Barb, for writing in. Vinny's mother-in-law, Barb Reed. Vinny is an amazing father, amazing son-in-law, and good to his wife. Short and sweet, but all very true.
Very kind. Facts, very kind.
Right over there.
I like to think Vinny's laughing his butt off now, hearing that musical rendition that you just played for him.
And if you don't know the story behind that, then another time, perhaps. But yes. This podcast is about him. So
there we go. All right. Vinny's Aunt Marie wrote in. She said she had a couple stories. Number one, when they came to Freeport where they lived, all the kids were very, very little. Vinny was about three, and his mom and Lynn and Aunt Marie took six kids into Wendy's, all done eating. Yes, I said done. Vinny saw a French fry enter some of the table and dove for it, shoving it in his mouth faster than any fast gun in the West. So Vinny likes his French fries.
Good choice.
Yeah. And then number two, she said they were visiting in Freeport again. Lynn and I had gone shopping and came home, unfortunately, with a full bladder. And there is Vinny with the horseshoe in his hand and an evil glint in his eyes, barring the entrance to the garage. And of course, he had the closest way into the bathroom with the picture in mind. Think of Vinny, maybe 6 years old, saying, "Sweet Aunt Marie." He couldn't pronounce my name properly at the time. I have a
Aunt
horseshoe.
Marie.
There you go. I have a horseshoe. The little devil child threatened to throw it at her. Lynn had to yell at him, laughing hysterically since he wouldn't move. Those are my Vinny stories. Have fun and love you to death, Vinny. Happy birthday. So there you go.
Oh, how sweet. Little Vinny.
Little Vinny.
His sister, my wife, Ashley, writes in, too many stories of Vinny to go through everything. When you only have a year apart between you and your little brother, you grow up being each other's best friend to start, and then love hate started as we got older. I have a good mix of the good and bad of Vinny. When we were probably around 7 and 8, I was able to teach my brother his first swear word. We were on the monkey bars in our backyard, and I told Vinny to say truck, but to replace the TR with the F sound. He proceeded to do so. And then me, being the great sister, ran into the house yelling to my mom that Vinny swore. I'm pretty confident he really had no idea what the word even meant at the time. Vinny constantly yelling, "Do me," whenever my mom was video recording and sticking his big noggin in the camera, which leads to my forever nickname of Vinny being Ovalhead. I think it probably started as an insult when we were in high school, but now it's always said out of love. For the stories above and for him hating me when I dated his friends in high school, he got me back. I went out drinking in high school with some friends, and we had beer cans and liquor in my car. I think I've heard this story. We cleaned out my car at the end of the night, but missed one beer can. Vinny borrowed the car the next morning, and when he got out of the driver's seat, apparently a beer can fell out. This was his perfect to run home and tell mom and dad. about it. Let's just say he won. Vinnie may seem very innocent on this podcast, but in his high school, he ran with some pretty shady crowd of little white country boys. One night, his group of friends thought it would be really funny to collect roadkill off the streets and put the dead carcasses on a girl's car they went to school with. I want to believe Vinny was an innocent bystander in this endeavor, but it was definitely written up in our newspaper's police beat the following day. Not sure if you can share this. Don't want the boy to get fired or anything. I think it's too late for that. So that is the second time the roadkill on the car story came up. You ever done anything like that, Justin?
No, when I was in high school, we would saran wrap cars where you just throw it underneath the car to get it really tight so someone would have to get scissors to cut it. But we never did eggs. We never did syrup because we always felt that was somebody did that to my car. Well, actually, I know who did it to my car. But we never really took it that far. Just the saran wrap and just a lot of driving up and down, you know, the main streets in Oak Lawn with nothing better to do. But yeah.
Good stuff. We would do the saran wrap and Loctite on the Beamers.
Oh, geez. We never did Loctite. Holy cow.
Oh, yeah. That was for when they really had it coming because, you know, I went to school with the rich kids. So when that car went, the next Beamer was already in the works. So
touche.
To finish off with Ashley's submission. Now on to the good. Vinny is an incredibly sweet soul, and we have grown very close as we become adults. And have matured him probably more than me after my divorce. Something I don't know. Just kidding. He was the only family member of mine that was truly wanted to listen to my side of the story and said he would always be there for me no matter what and backed up my decision. I think he was the last family member I talked to, but he was also so caring and attentive to the situation and let me know it was okay. This was everything I needed to hear. And I doubt he knows how thoughtful and healing that conversation was to me.
Wow.
We are still very much there for each other, whether it's complaining about our lovely kids, sending stupid memes, or venting to each other over light. He's a type of person that will always have your back. I would completely agree with that.
Very nice. That's really deep.
That is very deep.
I'm not going to lie. I didn't know that Ashley could go that deep.
Apparently she can. And I feel like I was the pretty much the cause of all those talks. So look at all the trouble I'm stirred up.
Let's just say it's a good thing. I don't want to get into the nitty gritty, but oh, good Lord.
Thank you. Like, yeah, this is about Vinny, but it's good to be here. So
let's just say it wouldn't be a podcast with the other guy.
Should we have him on?
No, God, no. All right. Anyway, I'm going to get myself in trouble. Let's see if it isn't clear about me. All right. Let's go on to Erica. My lovely wife wrote in, and let me say some of these stories she's got, I think it might say more about her than it says about Vinny. So let's see what she's got. Number one, Vinny's very first play date ended after only a couple hours. He made his friend cry. Mean old Vinny made poor little Charlie cry because Charlie wanted to go home because Vinny wouldn't play with him. He just sat and watched TV.
Of course.
Vinny loved Terminator back in the day and always went around saying, "I'll be back," and "Hasta la vista, baby." One time when we were out to eat, my dad got Vinny to go up to a table of older women and say, "Hasta la vista, baby," to them. Instead of laughing and thinking it was cute, those old hags all got offended. I bet they weren't very fun at parties. Okay. Number three.
This is definitely Erica.
Yes. In high school, Vinny and his group of friends got the cops called on them because they were out in the neighborhood at night dressed in black and shooting at each other with airsoft guns. They were going through people's yards and whatnot. They didn't get caught as they all ran when they heard the sirens. What a bunch of idiots. I just want to say the difference in stories between Erica and Ashley are very telling right now.
Very telling.
Here's another one. Vinny bought me dance pads for DDR for my birthday one year. I stopped playing, though, because he was better than me, like way better, ridiculously, embarrassingly better. She is very competitive, Erica. I don't know if you know this.
Definitely.
We went bowling once, her and I, with my sister, and my sister and I were goofing around throwing the bowling ball between our legs because we were just having fun. And she got so bent out of shape because we were still beating her. Very competitive. And then I know another time when her and Ashley used to live together at her apartment. Ashley went through and played all of her Mario on Wii and beat a bunch of levels that Erica hadn't beaten. So when I came over, I said, hey, let's play it. She goes, no, I don't want to play it anymore. My sister beat all the levels. It's dumb. I don't want to do it anymore.
We can restart it.
No, it's gone. It's useless.
Well, right. Ashley's definitely got a little bit of that in her too. Well, a lot of it. Very competitive, does not like to lose.
So. No. finishing up Erica, she's got two more stories. Vinnie once got written up in Freeport's police beat section at the newspaper because him and his friends threw a bunch of roadkill on his on a girl's car. They ended up
third time we bring in
first
that
time,
up.
Third time, yeah. They ended up confessing to our parents, who made them go apologize so they wouldn't get charged.
So we have the conclusion of that.
So they wouldn't get charged with destruction of property or whatever. What a bunch of idiots.
I have no idea who it was.
This is all Erica. I'm not saying Vinny is an idiot. I just want to preface that. Number six, final last story. After my sister stopped believing in Santa, I'm taken aback. I thought there was
Santa. Spoiler alert. We apologize. Yeah,
Somebody still puts presents under my tree. I don't know who it is. Every winter we'd always discuss if we thought Vinny still believed. It wasn't until junior high that they confronted him because we were afraid he was still believe and would get made fun of because kids are dicks. My wife talks. Turned out he stopped believing in Santa years ago but was too afraid to say anything and not get presents anymore. Love you, butthead. Happy birthday from Erica.
Oh, perfect.
All right.
Well, I think we're getting to our first
We have our first guest. Yes. Vinny, we have a guest for you. Should we bring them in?
Let's bring them in.
All right. How long do you want to take? Will we have to edit how long it takes to figure out how to do Zoom calls? We'll get it. We'll see.
We'll play this by ear.
All right, here we go.
I think Vinny can appreciate this process. So,
all right.
Bring it on in.
Caller, are you there?
On the hotline, we have.
They're on. You're on mute on still. Mute. Still on mute.
Still on mute.
Video.
There we go. We can hear you. Welcome to Baseball
there
and Whatever.
Hello.
If you haven't been able to tell, this is Vinny's parents, Lynn and Vince. They are here to share more stories about their lovely child and. I don't know. What else you got, Greg?
we brought them in. Instead of us reading their submissions, you're probably sick of hearing of us. So we want to bring in the two wonderful people, our in-laws, that raised this lovely young man, who apparently got himself in trouble with the law a lot more than we thought ended up confessing. We got to talk
about
that.
I don't know how I feel that my daughter's godfather was in the police beat. Kind of worries me a little bit.
Oh, man. Well, no, that doesn't worry me. The fact that he confessed to his crimes to his parents, that's where he went wrong, if you ask me. Not the crime itself. You're never in. What does Aladdin say? You're never in trouble unless you get caught. So
fair enough.
Either way, instead of listening to us for another however long we've been talking, because we've got a ton of submissions, we figured we'd bring in Lynn and Pretzel Vince to the podcast. So welcome, Vince. This is your second time on the podcast. And Lynn, this is your first. And we're ladies first, so the floor is yours to talk about your son, Vinny.
Okay. Now, there isn't going to be there's an old lady talking, is there?
No, your son is in charge of the soundboard. We don't have access to that. So.
Yeah, you're lucky. Good thing. You're kind of lucky he's not here. Otherwise, he would have sound drops for you guys, I'm sure.
He would have had that, that's for sure. Okay. I'm going to start when Vinny was a baby. He loved drinking his formula and his milk. He'd guzzle it down in no time flat. And we thought he could be a poster child for milk. So when he was about 1.5 years old, he got a little pudgy. So I nicknamed him Fat Boy. When he got older, my husband called him Fat Boy. And he said, don't call me Fat Boy, but Mom can. I thought that was pretty cool. Mama could do something, but Daddy couldn't.
Only Mom can call me Fat Boy.
Now, when Vinny was about 3, I took him to Dairy Queen. We're standing in line. There's, people in front of us and in back of us. And he says really loud, tell them I don't want green beans on it.
Wait,
there's a lot of chuckling in there. And I had to tell them they weren't green beans, but they were pickles. And I'll tell them that you don't want them. He hated anything green to eat and is still like that today.
Yeah, I can get on board with that.
He sent me something after Betty White died that she said she never ate anything green. And Vinny sent that to me and he's like, see, Mom, she lived to be almost 100.
Yeah, that is true. That, that is true. I like the logic. I like the logic there. So
did he. So now Vinny here is about 4, maybe 5. We had gone to the bank and I took out money for the week. Now he's sitting in the front seat with me. So as we're driving along, Vinny picked up a $100 bill, puts his hand out the window.
Oh my God.
And says, Mom, look at the money. And it's flapping in the wind. I could have died. Like, this is our money for 2 weeks. And it's out the window and it's windy out there. And I yelled to him, don't let go. And slowly bring your hand into the car. But I think that took a few years off my life.
I'm going to say it took a few years off of my life. Like the $100 bill.
Oh, my gosh. All I could see, it was flying away. And then there goes our money. So now Vinny's in first grade. So it's picture day. I had given him the money for the pictures. When he got home, I found the money still in his folder. So I asked him why he didn't give it in. He said he forgot, but his teacher, her and I were really, really good friends. She told me that she had asked for the money at school, so either he wasn't listening, wasn't paying attention, didn't hand it in. So I was so mad. So when the retakes happened, I told him he had to wear a suit to school for his retakes. He was not happy, and I told him I was not happy either that he didn't turn his money in the first time. Well, the picture turned out fine, but I did wish I had put him back in his red vest he had for the first picture day, because I did see that picture later on their class picture, and it was much cuter than him wearing his suit. All right, now Vinny is much older. Oh, this day took many years off my life. You okay?
Yeah.
Oh, so... He's like, uh-oh. Vinny was much older, and one day I was busy out and about, and I didn't see him much that day. So when I left, Vinny was with his friend Mike. So when I got home later, Vinny wasn't home. I asked my husband where he was, and he said he went out with Mike. So we ate dinner, and I figured Vinny would be home around midnight, which he usually was, or if he would call if he'd be late.
Uh-huh.
But I'm the mom that stays up until all my babies are home. So, of course, Vince went to bed. Now, Vinny wasn't home at 1 o'clock. He's not home at 2 o'clock. I called him several times and only got his voicemail. So I also called Mike, even though it's 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. I figured he was the last one to see him. So I called Mike, thinking maybe Vinny told Mike if he was going somewhere later that day. Mike's phone went to voicemail too. So I woke up my husband to tell him Vinny wasn't home yet. And he mumbled something like, nah, he's okay. He'll be home.
The boy's fine, dear.
No, he wasn't. Not in my mind.
He was dead on the side of the road. Yeah.
Thank you, Justin.
You're welcome.
I was going to search every ditch until I found him. Now it's 2 o'clock in the morning. And now it's 3 o'clock in the morning. And still no Vinny. I was going out of my mind with worry. Pictured him lying in that ditch. Well, my husband and I were supposed to be going to a Cub game the next day. And all I thought was, we'll have to give these tickets away because something bad happened to our son. Well, waking up Vince one more time around 4 in the morning did not help, but I'm still awake. So I ended up calling Mike's mom, Diane, hoping she could wake Mike up and ask him about Vinny. I asked Diane if Mike by any chance knew where Vinny was. And she says, yes, they're both at the YMCA for a lockdown with a bunch of kids.
Oh,
they had
no.
turned their phone phones off for the night. I tell you, I was never so relieved. As soon as she told me that he was okay and he's at the Y, oh, this great weight just lifted right off of me.
So really quick, did he not tell you he was there? Or?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Vinnie swears to this day that he told us he was going there that night. I still don't believe him. Because I would have remembered that. I was younger then. I remembered things.
So how far did you get in the funeral planning, just out of curiosity? Oh,
very far. I was going to give my tickets to the Waters and planning. You know, I really thought I was going to be planning his funeral the next day. And I said that to Kara the next day. And she laughed at me. She goes, if something happened to Vinnie, why do you think Steve and I are going to go to the Cub game? Like, I never thought of that. That never crossed my mind. All I knew is we're supposed to go to the Cub game and I had to give those tickets away because he was dead somewhere.
Oh, yes, I had him dead
and buried. That went far.
So we assume the worst. So.
Oh, boy.
Yes, mothers always assume the worst.
Got that
no
intuition.
No matter how old you guys get, your mothers will always be there worrying about you.
I suppose so. I suppose so. Can't help it. But
can't help it. All right. So now Vinny here is probably, he's probably about five or six here. It was on St. Patrick's Day. I don't know how you guys celebrate St. Patrick's Day with the kids or how you're going to, Justin, but this is what I always did. Like when I was teaching school, I would always have at lunchtime, have the janitor come in and mess up our classroom. And then when they would come back from lunch, it would be all messy. The kids were like screaming and running around because they'd be so excited. They could see the green sprinkles on the floor and they knew the leprechaun was there and it was all exciting. So I used to do that with the kids. So when Vinny got a little bit older, well, we were going to church. So I told Vince, I says, keep them in the car. I'm going to go upstairs and mess up their rooms really quick and hide the candy and all that kind of stuff. So when we got back home from church, Vinny walked into his room and saw it was all messy. And he's yelling, I didn't mess up my room. Because he knew if he messed up his room, I would be on him. Like, why is your room messy? And yelling at him. So he was quite upset until I told him that Leppy the leprechaun must have done it.
Ah.
So when he knew I wasn't mad, he was then happy to eat his candy.
Oh, well, see, I'd like to do that for our kids now, but unfortunately you try and mess up the house and you can't, you know, you wouldn't be able to make a difference on its current appearance. So,
you know, I kind of knew you were going to say that.
Yeah. That's kind of how, but I totally get, you know, the whole making it wasn't me, messing up the room. So I definitely feel for that. So,
oh my boy, we had so many stories about him.
Yeah. As we've seen through this podcast so far and all these, I think we're on page, what are we on page 17 or 18?
Yeah,
so
this is going to be one of the longer ones. This might be a longer episode.
Most submissions we've had. So before we switch over to Pretzel Vince, Pretzel Lynn, do you have anything else to share about your lovely son?
Yeah. Could I say two more stories?
You can say as many stories as
okay,
you want.
I got two more.
Even if we say no, you're the mother-in-law. So our power's automatically taken away. So, your stories.
Okay. So when Vinny was about three, I signed him up for a kinder gym at the Y. The girls had always taken the class before and they loved it. Well, the girls were now in school and I thought I could have some free time 2 days a week with Vinny and kinder gym. You know, I think it was like an hour and a half. So I thought, oh, just some time to myself. I was so excited. So the first time I took him, we hung up his coat, got him all settled in. And he was talking, you know, he was with a bunch of kids. They were talking to the teacher. And I walked out the door. He ran out the door, grabbed his coat, screaming after me. He didn't want me to go. I was like, oh. So I got him all settled down, told him I'd watch him for a bit. But I had to leave because mommies weren't allowed in class. Well, that satisfied him enough. He finished the class just fine, and he never had a problem again.
How about that?
I can still picture him, though, running out of the, following me down the hall, crying, screaming, grabbing his coat. It was like, it kind of felt like a bad mom. Like, you know, maybe I should have, like, but I was like, no, you just go. You'll be fine. An hour and a half.
Attached to mom a little bit.
What'd you say?
I said attached to mom a little bit. It sounded like
just
right
a little
there,
bit. Just a little bit. Okay, now he's 4 years old here. He had his first friend, Charlie, come over to play. They were both really excited. I think he knew him from preschool. Or no, daycare. Preschool. So Vinnie, when Charlie came over, Vinnie either played off by himself, didn't want to play with Charlie, or he was watching TV. After about half an hour, poor Charlie was crying because he wanted to go home since Vinnie didn't want to play with him.
Oh, no.
So his very first play date was a bust. Charlie went home, and it took him maybe another year or two until we would allow friends over to play with him.
I'm glad he hasn't done that to us when Greg and I are visiting with him. He just sits on the couch and tells us to go do something else. So at least we've broken that barrier with him. So that's
you have. Yeah. Good job, guys.
Yeah.
All right. I am done. Here's an old man that's going to talk to you.
Well, we don't have the sound drop, but really quick, Lynn, thank you so much for jumping on with us.
We certainly appreciate
it. Thanks for inviting us.
Of course.
And
your inaugural appearance on Baseball and Whatever. So now we are bringing in the man, the myth, the legend, Pretzel Vince. And we don't have the sound drop, but everyone knows what it is. So, ladies and gentlemen, Pretzel Vince making his second appearance on Baseball and Whatever.
He's got notes.
He's got notes. Oh, man, ready to go. He's probably got Bears thoughts too. He's gonna get.
Oh, I could talk about the Bears, but hey, thanks a lot for having us on. Appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I've got a slew of stories here. Starting with Vince when he was playing T-ball. It was a program through the Park District. One of these, I don't know if it was 4 or 5 days, but the last day they had a T-ball game between both sides. I think there were like 10 kids on the side. You know, they just put them all out there and everybody batted through twice.
Right.
So they had Vince playing either shortstop or third base. Problem was he tried to make every play. Midway through the second inning, they put him out into the outfield because he would just run in front of kids, grab the ball, knock them over, and, you know, he was trying to get the ball in every play. So he ended up being put out in the outfield. So that was his T-ball experience.
That sounds like a birth of a soccer player to me, if you ask me.
Oh, wait, that's my next story. When he started playing soccer, again, it was through the Y, if I'm not mistaken. And when young kids play soccer, they don't spread out. It's kind of like they call it bunch ball or amoeba ball. So one child gets the ball, they start to dribble, everybody runs on top of them because the kids can run faster without the ball than when they have the ball. So you get this blob of kids, and it's like an amoeba moving down the field. Well, Vince had a great way to stop that. He would just let the group get together, and then he'd run and just jump on the pile, knock everybody down, and he'd come up holding the ball. It was like, that's not what soccer is, but he was real proud. Hey, I got the ball from everybody. When he was a swimmer in high school, and he was on the swim team, and when they warm up, just like in baseball, if you're on the on deck circle, you have a lead bat or you got the donut ring to put on the baseball bat to swim around.
Exactly.
Okay. What they would do is they'd wear what was called a drag suit. It was fit over their swim trunks and it had holes in it. So again, it's slowing you down.
Mm-hmm.
Vince is such a competitor. He gets up for his event, dives into the water and starts swimming and got halfway and he stopped right in front of the stands. He was in that lane and he starts like he's like jitterbugging in the water. Can't figure out what he's doing. All of a sudden, off comes his drag suit, he throws it up and he takes off swimming. Afterwards, it's like, what happened? He says, I forgot I had my drag suit on. I
forgot to take it off.
Yeah, but he couldn't put his feet on the bottom of the pool or he's disqualified.
Right.
So there he is, you know, like he's, you know, kicking water and everything. In all fairness to him, it was a 6-person race. With that delay, he came in fourth, which I thought was pretty good. I was pretty proud of him.
That's
but it was kind of funny because everybody's sitting there. Naturally, I'm the parent, and they're saying, what's he doing? What's he doing? I said, I have no idea. I don't know what kind of stroke that is that he's doing, but yeah, he did get it off. Another story, when he was younger.
Really quick, was Lynn there? Did she think he was drowning at any point when he was trying to get that
drag suit up? No, thank goodness she wasn't.
Okay.
The problem was back then, the meets would start like at about 4 o'clock. Lynn didn't get out of school until 3. Okay. It was in Rockford. And so, in fact, I think it was at Boylan High School. But anyway, she wasn't there. Or yeah, you're probably right. She probably would have been yelling and screaming at me to go dive in there and save him, you know?
Pretzel Vince to the rescue. So
yeah. And oh, by the way, Jay, thanks a lot for, you know, mentioning when Lynn was telling you about how we couldn't find Vince that one night. Oh, he was probably lying in a ditch. Well, you know, I've never lived the story down because I kept telling her he's fine. He's fine.
Yeah. That's my parents. Thanks a lot.
No soup
way.
For you.
My parents would have been the same way for sure.
So Vince went to the soccer camp at Wisconsin Whitewater. And I think he was like 10, 11 years old. It was a week camp. He went with his buddy, Brian. And we called him Tuesday or Wednesday just to make sure he wasn't homesick. And I called him up, got him on the phone. We had a nice chat about the camp and everything was going along fine. And I said, hey, your mom wants to talk to you. He's like, okay, fine. So Lynn gets on the phone and all I hear is, hi, honey, how you doing? Are you having fun? Are you, what? Oh, okay. I'll talk to you later. Okay, have fun. Bye. Hangs the phone up. And I said, what was that?
Yeah.
He says, well, evidently, your son's more interested in the Rocky Rococo pizza that just was delivered than talking to me. He was worried that by the time he got off the phone with mom, there'd be no pizza left. So as soon as that pizza came, he was running for the pizza. He couldn't get off the phone fast enough. So
justified if he asked me. The boy's got to eat. So.
Yeah, it comes with the territory.
No, I your mother-in-law to hear
can
that.
Can Lynn hear that? Is she still in the room? Probably
no,
dead meat
I'm
tomorrow.
Here.
Uh-oh, she's I'm dead meat. Side. So
thanks, Greg.
Yep, anytime. I'm a you dead know, man tomorrow.
Yeah. I'm still going to hear about the whole incident about him not being home on time too. But anyway. You know, Lynn told a story about Leppy the leprechaun coming and messing up his room, and he was all upset about that. Well, he went through a period, which is hard to believe, but in a period in his life where he thought it was really cool. He didn't have to hang up any of his clothes. He just threw them on the floor. So he'd start out with a pile of clean clothes, and as he wore them, he'd have a pile of dirty clothes, a pile of clean clothes. Well, one day, mom came, walked past his room, saw it, and said, what is that? And he explained it to her, and she did tell him to clean the room up. This all happened when I wasn't home. So I come home from work, and I notice the door is closed. And I'm like, why is the door closed? So I knock on the door, and I hear, who is it? It's me. Open the door. So the door opens, and all I see is one eye peeking out at me. I'm like, what's going on? He says, is mom home? I go, no, she's not home. Then the door opened up. I looked and I go, what's this? He goes, well, mom told me to clean it up, but I really don't want to. I said, I'm going to clean it up. I said, shut the door. So when mom came home, I said, oh, by the way, we're going to start a new thing in the house. She goes, what's that? He's just going to keep his door shut. Don't even look in his room. So that didn't go over too big, but at least we had a little peace in the house because he did keep the door closed then, and mom didn't worry about it. She's like, well, okay, he's old enough to make those decisions. So speaking about his room, I don't know if Ashley mentioned this story, but when he was in grammar school, Ashley came into the front, into the family room, and she said, there's a smell coming from Vince's room. I said, what kind of smell? She goes, Dad, he's a boy. Boys stink. I don't know. It just stinks. So I walked into the room, and yeah, sure enough, something did smell a little rank. So Vince wasn't home yet. He comes home, and I said, hey, something smells in your room. And he just gives me this look like, oh God, they know. So I said, what's in your room? He goes, I don't know. Okay. So we start. So we kind of nailed it to where it was by his dresser. So I said, okay, let's start pulling stuff out. Something's in here and it smells. We get through the first drawer and we find a sandwich that looked like a science project.
Oh, it was still
wrapped up. Yeah.
Nice.
It was still wrapped up in the baggie.
Yeah.
Didn't open it because it smelled. And I was like, God only knows what's going to jump out of that. So I looked at him. I said, what's this? He said, well, I wasn't hungry that day and I didn't want to get in trouble. So he took
his
dresser drawer.
Oh,
yeah. Nice. Do you remember what kind of sandwich it was?
I think it was a peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
Okay. All right.
Justin, you're a big peanut butter guy.
The mistake is he went with jelly. You never go with jelly.
It was green and it just hairy. Oh.
He's
I couldn't wait to throw it in
life.
The garbage and throw it outside.
Yeah, seriously. Oh, man.
Then Vince went to another soccer camp. And it was right here in Freeport by the community college. And it was real hot. It was one of those summers where it's like 90 degrees at 7 o'clock in the morning, just brutally hot. So it was the last day of the soccer camp and it was going to be even hotter. And mom, being concerned as she was about her little fat boy, wanted him to wear a hat to protect his little head.
Not Lynn. No, never.
So he wore the hat. And I came home from work, and I came home about 4 o'clock. And Vince turns around, he looks at me. He's at the computer. He turns around, looks at me, and smiles. And I look at him, and I look at him again. I look at him a third time. I'm like, my God, he reminds me of that kid from Goonies. What was his name? Sloth.
Sloth. Yeah.
He reminds me of Sloth, except Vinny had a full set of teeth. His head had swollen at soccer camp.
Oh,
and they couldn't get his hat off his head.
Oh, my God.
Fortunately, the doctor is like right across the street. So mom takes him to the doctor. What's the doctor say? Never seen anything like that before. It took about 3 days for his head to come back down the size.
Jeez.
In fact, Ashley always called him Oval Head. And I tell you, his head looked like a football the way it swelled up with that hat on. Of course, that does explain a lot now about Vince. You know, think about that. It happened when he was younger. Another quick story. He was on the swim team. He loved water. He loved to swim. So we went out to see his Aunt Ellen in Ohio. She wasn't married yet. She was living in an apartment complex. They had a swimming pool. She said, you guys are more than welcome to use the pool. She wasn't going to be home by the time we got there. She was working. So we got there and we went into the pool and we're having a good time and everything. And I have the kids jumping in the water. I'm in about 5 feet of water. And they jump in and I let them go underwater, grab them and then throw them to the ladder. Erica, you know, she could paddle there. Ashley was another story, but she was having a good time. And I kind of had to actually throw her because she couldn't swim and she hated water, but she was having a good time.
Still hates it.
And then it would be Vince. So it was Erica, Ashley and Vince. They're jumping in like that and everything's fine. Evidently, I wasn't moving fast enough for Vince because as Ashley jumps in the water, I catch him out of the corner of my eye jumping in. So I'm like, I got to get Ashley out because she's deathly afraid of water. So with one hand, I grab Ashley, throw her towards the ladder. The other hand, I reach underneath the water, grab Vince by his arm and pull him up. He's coughing, spitting up water and everything. And I get him to the side, calm him all down and everything. I said, are you okay? He's like, yeah, I'm fine. So Erica jumps in. Now I say, okay, come on. So Erica jumps in the water and out of the corner of my eye, I see Vince jumping back into the water again. Fortunately, as I said, Erica could swim. So I push her towards the ladder. She swims. And again, I grab him. This time I pull him up out of the water. He's just laughing. I'm like, what are you laughing about? Your mother's going to kill me. But he always loved water. He just loved it and was never afraid of it, which was kind of scary because especially at that age, he's jumping in. Ashley was afraid of it, which was good. I didn't have to worry about her doing anything stupid. But Vince, on the other hand, you know, everybody in the pool, let's go.
Love it.
You know, Greg, he always calls you the boomer, right? Because you're complaining a lot.
I am known as that on the podcast here.
Right. So. Well, remember Nintendo Wii?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Okay. We bought one. And the game we all seemed to like was Tiger Woods Golf. And I loved that game, too. I really enjoyed it.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
So one night, Glenn and I go out, and Vince is having some friends over, and he says, yeah, we're gonna play Wii. I said, okay, fine, no big deal. So we get home around 9 o'clock, and you know how our downstairs is when you come in through the garage.
Yeah.
Walk in through the garage, and I smell cigars. I smell cigar smoke. So I walk into the rec room, and there's Vince with three of his buddies. They're smoking cigars. They're playing Wii Golf. And they look like they're 60 years old. I think he's a boomer that's still in the closet. I go, what are you guys doing? We're playing golf.
Oh, that is amazing.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, they're just playing golf, smoking cigars. And like I said, the way they were dressed, they looked like they were 60 years old. So he's the boomer.
Okay, Vince, you bring up an excellent point because I think we've had multiple forms of evidence already where Vinny is a young man, but trapped in an old man's body.
So yeah.
We have playing Wii Golf, smoking cigars. And then we have, was it Dr. Mantis Toboggan wrote in and said he went on power walks with his 5 pound weights.
5 pound weights. Like yeah.
Yeah.
So we have to redesignate our positions here on the podcast or whatever. I'm more of a boomer for my views, but Vinny's an actual boomer.
He's an actual boomer.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
I think we're gonna have to revisit this designation a little bit. So
for sure.
Well, just I didn't have this story, but you bring this up. There used to be a program on Sunday mornings out of the Monroe radio station, and it was big band music, and the guy was on for I don't know 3-4 hours. So Vince, when he left college, he and Gretchen moved in, and he calls me up one day. He says, hey, Dad, what was that radio station where the guy played the big band music? So I had to tell him it was WEKZ 93.7. He used to listen to that. He just turned me on to a Spotify playlist that's right out of Bosch with the real nice jazz music. So I think there's a lot there that, you know, yeah, he's an old man there in a young guy's body.
We are building our case right over
here. We are. So. Oh, my God.
I got one last story. And this one pertains to soccer. And he had his shining moment in high school. They were playing Harlem High School. And he was on a competitive soccer team. But in high school, you know, everybody plays for their own high school.
Yeah.
So he was playing against some guys that were on his competitive soccer team, some real nice guys. But when they got on the field, they were being competitive. And it was a game that went back and forth, and it ended up as a 2-2 tie. However, based on the rules in high school, they went to overtime. Okay. So in the overtime period, Vince had two wonderful plays. First one is he made a pass, about a 40-yard pass, put it right on his teammate's head. The kid headed the goal in, ball in, scored a goal. It's 3-2.
Beautiful.
Yeah. They go back and forth. We get the ball back. Again, same player. Vince makes another 40-yard pass to this player. Puts the ball on his foot. One-time shot in the goal. Freeport ends up winning 4-2.
All right. Nice.
It was really nice. I always remember that moment in time.
Yeah.
And it couldn't happen at a better time because he's playing against his friends from his competitive soccer team.
Sure.
So it was really fun. It was really fun. And I figured I'd end on a good note after exposing him with everything else that he did growing up. So I just want to say, Vince, happy birthday from the old man talking. So.
Well, thank awesome. You, guys. Appreciate it.
Happy birthday, Vinny.
Guys, thank you again so much for coming on. You guys, I think you guys stole the show right here.
For sure.
Hey, thanks a lot for having us.
Of course.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
You're official podcasters now.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
We'll have to start our own.
That would be an interesting listen.
Hey, everybody, the old people are talking.
Oh. We got the title already, so.
All right. Yeah, there we do. We do. But hey, thanks a lot, guys. Yeah. Really appreciate
it. It was a lot of fun.
Anytime. Absolutely. We'll catch you guys later.
Okay. All right, take care.
Guys. Bye. Bye, guys.
See ya.
How awesome. So we've reached the, I think we've reached the last two, Justin. We've had a ton of content to you. So we're just going to wrap up the finale right now. I'm going to continue next with a submission from a fellow named Kevin Finn.
I'm loving, I was reading ahead of this and I'm loving this message, by the way.
Oh, yes, indeed. This is a fantastic message. And Vinny's lovely wife, Gretchen, took the liberty and reached out to Kevin Finn, who, if you do not know, is Vinny's boss.
That's incredible. So,
Kevin writes in, first thing, should I start calling him Vinny or will he know you told me that? So he's going to be Vinny around the office right now. I guess he was just Vince.
Yeah, that just seems so weird to me. Vince is his father. It's not
Vince
him.
Vince is Pretzel Vince. Yeah, he's Vinny. So I guess he's Vince at his place of employment. But Kevin, thank you for writing into us, Kevin. Thanks for playing along with us. We really appreciate it. Vince is pretty quiet around the office. You should listen to him here.
Yeah.
And I had no idea he had a podcast. Until we talked about it last week. So look at that. You know, he's getting to know the boss.
Vinny, you're supposed to be networking and telling people we have a show.
What are you doing? Wearing my shirt in lieu of my work uniform. Yeah. So I like having Vince in the office because he is a genuine guy to be around. We like to talk about sports and family. I'm sorry, but I do not know of a funny story about Vince yet. But I do know that he is a hardworking, conscientious, and willing to help whenever possible. He is a professional in every sense of the word, and I can tell he is very devoted to his family. He is a super colleague, and he has a very bright future with Le Mans. I guess that's his company. Didn't he hand in his 2-week notice? Never mind. You get him in trouble. And I know that he and everyone else in the accounting department wants his ERP system implemented ASAP. What the hell is that? So we can move forward and enjoy a better work-life balance. Vinny, if you're implementing that, I'm sure that sounds like massive change.
That sounds like TPS reports to me, Greg. I don't know if you've ever seen Office Space.
Exactly. That's amazing. Great job, Justin. Great
Thank
job.
You. Thank you.
Vinny sounds like he's the man at the office. There's got to be a funny story, though. There's got to be Kevin from the office, like someone walked in the bathroom after him. And it was,
I'm
like,
just
really
thinking of him like, is George Costanza working somewhere, you know, being like doing something wrong? And is that frowned upon here? Because if I got to plead ignorance, because if I would have known, it's not me.
Exactly. So this is where this gets funny right here. We may have started something here. So once we get there, I would like to learn more about Vinny from a personal standpoint. Well, this is a good start. Kevin,
you're going
to
get the full...
the podcast. You get the full, especially this episode alone.
Yeah.
And be able to hear funny stories again this episode. It would be nice for my wife and I to get together with you, meeting Gretchen, not me, and Vince to start developing a friendship. That's right, Vinny. We've gone and done it. You are now friends with your boss. You guys are going to go on double dates, do things together. So you're welcome for that.
I feel like we deserve a finder's fee for this, right? Like
I believe so. Well, that gets him in at the company now. Now we can be partner or something. I don't know. It's not a law firm, I guess, but do accountants do that too?
I don't know. You're talking to the wrong guy.
That's what he does, right? He's an accountant.
He's cooking the books. He's gonna hate us when this is over.
I know, but from what I see, you have yourself a heck of a husband. Again, talking to Gretchen, and a father to your two children. Again, talking to Gretchen. How can I access the podcast? What time does it run? Justin, how can we access baseball?
You can access baseball and whatever by checking out any podcast app. If you have an iPhone, there's a podcast app already on there, and just search baseball and whatever, and you will find all the plethora of content and episodes and side projects that we have done, including this. You can also find it on YouTube by searching baseball and whatever. Eventually, the video version of this will get up. That will take a little bit longer, but the audio version will hopefully be up either by Saturday morning or Sunday morning of this week. So let's, Kevin. Oh, you are in for a treat, my friend.
and he says, thank you for reaching out, and take care. Sincerely, Kevin. So yeah. And if you don't know too, Kevin, Vinnie took the helm in football season of Blast from the Past. I think he did.
Yes, he did.
Several episodes of that. So go check that out. Vinnie going solo, but he's quite the podcaster. So Kevin, if you're listening, please give the man a big raise. So, he's definitely deserved it. So
well deserving of it for sure.
And like I said, thanks again for playing along with us. Hopefully it catches Vinny by surprise or something. His wife probably told him already, but that's okay.
I'm guessing she leaked the deets on this one. We do have one final story from Gretchen, which I will go ahead and read before we wrap up. And it says, this is supposed to be said like on a family vacation when the dad says that one line, you know what I'm talking about, Gretchen? I don't know what you're talking about, but I'm going to read it anyway. Greg, do you know what she's talking about?
This is supposed to be said like on family vacation. So are we supposed to read this on family vacation? I don't know.
I have no idea. Gretchen, okay. What do you mean? Anyway,
what do you mean, Gretchen?
This says, she says, happy birthday, you 80-year-old man trapped in a 33-year-old man's body. The most patient man I have ever met. Will eat anything. Schlitz loving, dry joke. Travel loving. Every time we leave the driveway, he says, this takes me back.
hold on. Does that mean is that like nostalgia, or does it literally mean he's reversing out of the driveway? So this takes me back. Like I'm literally going backwards.
I'm guessing that's
what
it.
What the hell? He is the boomer. Another reference to an 80-year-old man in a 33-year-old body. He's not even 33 yet, is he? He's still 32 technically.
I think he'll be 33 Sunday, right? She also says he's a hardworking CPA, a vanilla extract chicken maker.
What the heck is that?
I don't know what that means. We will ask. We will get more details. And she also says he is the best father of their two kids and a hell of a husband. I can only imagine, Vinny. She also
definitely
says
hell of a husband.
One story, their daughter, Emmeline, on the way to have Emmeline, she was in the middle of a big contraction and he sent on the sign said road work ahead. And Vinny pulls out a dad joke and says, well, I hope the road works ahead.
What?
Come on, Vinny. That's like my level of joke. Come on. And he said, she said it was the worst timing ever not to add, she was waiting until our podcast recording was done that night to tell him she was in labor.
Oh, man. We told him to go.
We told him at any time to go.
We want immunity from this. We told him.
Yes, this is not our fault. Yeah. This is not our fault. So, thank you.
I hope the road works ahead. I have never heard that before. But yeah, you're right. I could see you just think something like that.
Vinny has a very dry sense of humor.
He does.
So I could definitely see that being the case.
The whole this takes me back. That is interesting.
I could also see that. And I'm going to use that now on Erica this whenever we pull back out of the driveway. And she's
that has like double meaning.
I guess.
I don't know.
It's a double entendre.
What about vanilla extract chicken maker? What is that?
I have no clue what that means.
Vanilla extract.
We will definitely ask him when we see him tomorrow. So
I believe so.
So yeah. There you go.
Vinny, happy birthday. Our dear, dear friend, we love you. You're the greatest. And I hope you've enjoyed all of this because everyone definitely was very excited to submit anything they had, as you can tell of everything you listened to. Great, wonderful stories. Definitely some surprises for us too. So this has been your birthday pod. I hope you've enjoyed. And consider you slimed, Vinny, but all in good fun, of course. So,
yes, Vinny, thank you for putting up with Greg and I on this endeavor and being a good brother-in-law and being helpful and supportive and all those good things. And here's to many more birthdays that we can rag on each other with in the future.
Absolutely. This has been Baseball and Whatever, and consider him slimed, him being Vinny. Episode 10 of this. You can reach us at baseballandwhatever@gmail.com on social media, some variation of @baseballandwhat. We are, of course, partnered with the Billy Up Sports Podcast Network. Follow them on all social medias. Check out their website. And I think, Justin, this is normally your job, but
doing great.
I'll just leave it at that. We have one closing song for you, Vinnie, to send you off, and wishing you a happy birthday, my friend. Vinnie, you take care.
Vinnie, for the love of God, tell your coworkers about the podcast.
Makes me feel sad for.